I welcome you all to this NRC session being conducted by SRCC, and I had a video recorded earlier which was on competitive strategies and business warfare, and now I'll be going far more specific into detailing competitive strategies and business warfare in the context of various types of market structures that exist in a system, in an economic system. When we are looking at an economic system, we could be looking at geographically, we could be looking at regionally, we could be looking at over a period of time. That is, either it could be location based or it could be time based. But when we are looking at market structures, what is extremely important is that we generally categorize market structures on the basis of number of sellers in the market, point number one, or on the basis of the types of products that are being offered, and number three, on barriers to entry and exit. Now, first of all, we need to understand what is a market structure. According to me, a market structure primarily comes down to how the firms in an industry are organized. This is not a perfect definition, but then how many firms are there, what kind of products they have, and what are the various barriers to entry and exit that exist. These are the core three fundamental, you know, 3 points on which any market structure needs to be looked at. In economics, we define market structures under conditions of perfect competition, monopolistic competition. We look at oligopoly, we look at duopoly, and we look at monopoly. Now, most of the times we have no clarity on what is this nature of market structure. You know, if I look at monopoly, most of the time we end up giving an example of Indian Railways as a monopolist. Yes, Indian Railways is a monopoly on a national level, because it is an administered monopoly, it is controlled by the government. But we are not looking at monopolies wherein we are looking at commercial monopolists. We are not looking at monopolists that are not administered but are the only player in the market. So it becomes important for me, because the theoretical construct says that we are looking at commercial monopoly. That is, a monopoly where there is a single firm producing a product for which there are no close substitutes, and there are very strong barriers to entry. In order to understand these nuances in the context of a real life example, let me take you to a monopoly wherein you are looking at the production of a book, and that book is a very religious book, and that's the Bible. If you look at the Guinness Book of World Records, it's the largest selling book in the world. But to produce the Bible, you need a very specialized kind of paper. Now, what are the qualities of that paper, and who's producing that paper? If I look at the qualities of the paper that a Bible requires to be produced, number one, it has to be very light, because Bible being a voluminous text, I can't have paper which is heavy in terms of a very high GSM. Paper is measured in terms of GSM. So I can't have paper which is very heavy. I need paper which is very light. Number two, I need a paper which will have a very long life. That is to say, once I buy a Bible, it will be with me maybe for the rest of my life. That means it should have a very long life. It should not get corroded. It should not get, it should not be subject to, being torn away by insects. And number three, we are looking at the printing quality of the paper should be very good. That is, that means not only should the book be light, but it should be legible. I could easily read it. So portability becomes a very important point. Now, how many producers of Bible? Now, in India, if I look at regionally, in India, there's only one organization that has, you know, that produces the Bible. That is, it prints the Bible, and that is the Bible Society of India. The Bible Society of India has a single supplier of the paper that is required to print the Bible, and that is the paper division of ITC from Bengal. In the world, there are four companies that produce such kind of paper. That means if I look at the world market as a market structure, then it becomes an oligopoly. But if I look at not in the production of the Bible, but in the supply of paper. But if I look at India as a region, then only within India, there's a single supplier, and that single supplier becomes a monopolist because, number one, he's a sole seller. Number two, he's producing a product for which there are no close substitutes available. That is, based on the requirements of the Bible Society of India, there could be n number of paper producers, but the paper quality and the features of that paper that Bible Society of India needs are being manufactured by only one player. And number three, because of its expertise, ITC Paper Division has created a very strong barrier to entry for other firms to enter this market. It becomes a commercial monopolist. It's not an administered monopoly. It is not a fiscal monopoly. It is a monopoly that is able to operate in the market, guided by not necessary profit maximization objectives. Theoretically, we say profit maximization, but the company could have very strong objectives wherein it is trying to become, continue to maintain its competitive advantage in the market. And that's what I'm trying to clarify, that when we start looking at structures where we are looking at what kind of competition. So in a monopoly, theoretically speaking, it is the complete absence of any kind of competition. There is no competition in a monopoly. But a monopolist has to always remember that there is possibility of potential competition. In case the barriers to entry are difficult, I'll not use the word impossible, are difficult, then there could be a player who comes into the market with a superior value offer. And if that happens, then the monopoly power of the existing firm breaks. So the existing firm, which is a monopoly, has to ensure that it continues to have that competitive advantage which no other company has. And that is where the challenge is. That means you're competing not with any third party, you're competing with an invisible competitor who may appear in the future because he has a better technology. So you're competing actually with yourself. On what levels? On two levels. Number one, improving your market offer. That is, you continue to upgrade not just the product, but the entire market offering. And when I use that word market offering, I'm using the word product, I'm using the word promotion, I'm using distribution, I'm using people, I'm using physical evidence, and I'm using processes. All the six P's except price. Why not price? Because the second category on which you will compete would be by bringing your cost down. As I said in my earlier lecture, that what is value to the buyer? Value to the buyer is actual or perceived benefit divided by the cost. Now, the cost is in terms of what? The price that the buyer pays plus the time, effort and energy that he is spending to acquire that particular product offer. Now, you got to remember the numerator and the denominator. It's actual slash perceived benefit divided by cost. And cost is in terms of real cost, that is price that the buyer pays plus the time, effort and energy that goes into it. So what is the marketer doing? What is then ITC challenged by? ITC Paper Division is being challenged by continuously improving its product offering in terms of its processes, physical evidence, people, in terms of its tangible product, in terms of its promotion activities, in terms of its distribution. But simultaneously, it is also being challenged by the fact that how can it maintain its costs? How can it keep its costs lower? Because if you look at the prices of paper, you'll always find that the cost of paper production is continuously going up. Why? Because paper is dependent upon Mother Nature for the raw material. That is wood. Coming back again to monopoly and trying to explain now monopoly in terms of a market structure wherein you're looking at an administered monopoly. Again, I'll not give the example of Indian Railways. I'll give you another example. And one of the best examples to illustrate this point is an organization called Mysore Paints and Varnishes Limited, MPVL. Mysore Paints and Varnishes Limited. Now, this particular organization makes what is called indelible ink. What is indelible ink? Indelible ink is the ink that is applied on your forefinger after you have cast your vote in an election. So, when, now look at elections. Now, in India, it is the only producer and supplier of this particular product to the Election Commission of India, right? Now, you've got to understand that you will think that there is one buyer and there is one seller. The seller being Mysore Paints and Varnishes Limited and one buyer, which is the Election Commission of India. The answer is no. Mysore Paints and Varnishes Limited not only sells to the Election Commission of India, but sells it across a lot of Southeast Asian economies. For example, it will be selling to Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, wherever you're looking at democratic elections being held. So this indelible ink is the ink that is put on your forefinger. And what is so unique about it? The product cannot be washed away by either rinsing it in water, by applying soap or any other chemical. That means they have a very unique formulation which is, you know, privy to the organization, and they will not share it with anybody else. Now, it is one seller and many buyers. But now look at what has happened. I have changed the geographical boundaries of its operation. It is not only looking at India, it is looking at a Southeast Asian region. So every time, the first principle of competition is that I define the domain in which I'm going to compete. That is extremely important. And if I define the domain in which I'm going to compete, then I need to have a very strong competitive advantage in that particular structure. Coming back to understanding, you know, competition and strategy in the context of market structures, we need to look at a second very important point, and that is, you know, the nature of the product that is being offered. If I look at, you know, I'll start with briefly brief you on perfect competition, because when you're looking at perfect competition, actually perfect competition never exists in the real world. It is a theoretical construct that has been incorporated in textbooks because it serves as a benchmark against which other market structures are evaluated. It serves as an ideal market structure, a utopian market structure. Now, perfect competition requires 8 conditions to be satisfied. Number one, it requires that you are dealing with an extremely large number of buyers and sellers. Now, that word is very important for us to understand, that word extremely large. And I'll demonstrate it to you with a numerical example. What does extremely large mean? Extremely large means that the market share of one particular firm in that particular market, in that perfectly competitive market, should be infinitely small. Now, how do I show that? I'll come to all these points, but first let me list out all the 8 points that go into making a perfectly competitive market, because from there on I'll build up on competitive strategy and business warfare. So number one, extremely large number of buyers and sellers. Number two, we are looking at homogeneous products. Homogeneity has to be understood. You know, I'm not looking at similar products. I'm looking at identical products. And if firms are producing identical products, how does the nature of competition change? Because everybody is producing in that particular market structure identical products. That means identity has to be understood again in 2 concepts. Technological identity, and I look at economic identity. Are they technologically identical products? Are they economically identical products? In order to understand the third point, where I'm looking at, you know, barriers to entry. In case of perfect competition, there exist no barriers to entry. That means there are no entry barriers, there are no exit barriers. Again, barriers need to be understood, that what are the kind of barriers that exist in a market? Are they created by law? Do you have a patent? Do you have a trademark? Do you have a registered use of a trademark? Or are those barriers created by the competition itself that new firms find it extremely difficult to enter the market? Point number 4 is the goal of profit maximization. These 4 conditions the goal of profit maximization being pursued by the firm, both in the short run and in the long run, make the markets, these first four conditions, make the market structure a pure competitive market. It's a pure competition. Now, for perfect competition to exist, we need to bring in four additional conditions. What are those four additional conditions? Number one, no government intervention. The government doesn't intervene in the working of the markets. There is no market today where the government does not have intervention, especially in India. Whether through taxes, that is GST, whether through corporate tax, whether through other legal provisions, the government can have a say in the working of your business environment. Point number six, theoretically there has to be no government intervention, right? But practically speaking, it's a utopian concept. It never happens. Point number six is that we are looking at perfect knowledge. We need to understand what perfect knowledge is. Perfect knowledge has various very strong connotations. It makes a very strong assumption that buyers and sellers have access to all information. Now, what does that all information mean? It means that they have perfect knowledge of the past, they know the present, and they can predict the future with certainty. It also assumes that information is free. That means if I want to have access to information, it will be available and I can obtain it free of charge. Those aspects of perfect competition, especially in the context of perfect availability of knowledge amongst buyers and sellers, makes it a very unrealistic assumption. But it is defining that, again, an ideal concept, that utopian concept. The next point that makes a market structure perfectly competitive is the concept of perfect mobility of factors of production. That means factors of production have two kinds of mobilities. Number one, geographical mobility. And number two, occupational mobility. Is it really true that land, labor, capital, entrepreneurship can easily move across industries, across regions? When I start looking at these four factors of production and start looking at mobility of factors of production, I need to look at each one of them distinctly. Land, labor, capital, entrepreneurship. Land by definition is immobile. But land has mobility. How? Land has mobility in terms of transfer of ownership. I may be a resident of region A, but if the law permits and I satisfy all the criteria, I can be owning a plot of land in region B. So in that context, land has mobility. The second point is occupational mobility. When I'm looking at occupational mobility, we're trying to understand that can factors of production move from one industry to another industry with equal ease? The answer is most of the times not. If I'm in the teaching profession, tomorrow I cannot become an astronaut. I don't have that skill set. And that's what perfect competition assumes, that there is perfect mobility of factors of production. The answer is no. Even within an industry, there would be constraints for labor to move from one firm to another firm. I may be performing extremely well in organization A. I may not be ending up performing extremely well in organization B because the environment of that firm differs. So labor will no longer remain equally productive when it moves from one occupation within an industry to a similar occupation in the same industry because things change. Another factor that makes perfect competition highly unrealistic, which is the eighth assumption, is the assumption of no transportation costs. Now, that was an assumption that was incorporated in the market structure or in the in the theory of economics to ensure that we had a single price prevailing. Now, you got to remember that within a particular industry, under conditions of perfect competition, we tell our students that there's only one price prevailing in the market. That is not an assumption of perfect competition. That is an outcome or an implication of those eight conditions being satisfied, and we are looking at a outcome as a single price prevailing in the market for that particular product that is being considered. Now, if I look at perfect competition, look at these eight conditions. If I look at the first three or four conditions alone, I'll find that the word perfect competition is a misnomer. Misnomer in the sense, perfect competition means that the nature of competition is perfect. But perfect competition actually means a market in which there is no competition. Firms do not compete on any of those seven P's. They don't compete on, they don't compete on product because everybody is producing the homogeneous product. They don't compete on price because the price is being determined by the market forces of demand and supply, right? The industry forces determine and there's a single price prevailing, so they don't compete on price. They don't compete on promotion. They don't need to. Why? Because everybody has perfect knowledge. Now, if they have perfect knowledge, then why do you need to promote your product? Whether it is advertising, personal selling, direct marketing, you know, sales promotion, you name it, you don't need to promote your product. Do they compete on physical distribution? The answer is no. Why don't you compete on physical distribution? Because if you look at a perfectly competitive market, it assumes that there are no transportation costs. So you're not competing on product, price, place, promotion. What about processes, people, and physical evidence? Now we need to understand that. When we are saying that there will be competition in a perfectly competitive market, the objective of the firm becomes to maximize profits. Now, in order to maximize profits, given the price, every firm is driven by the fact, or theoretically speaking, is driven by the fact that we need to reduce our costs. How do you reduce your cost? Now, that's one of the strategies to remain competitive in the market. In order to understand these eight conditions and then take you to the other market structures, such as duopoly, oligopoly and monopolistic competition, I need to explain two very important concepts to you. Number one, the concept of homogeneous products. Or before that, let me start with the first condition, extremely large number of buyers and sellers. One of the bases in which we understand a market structure is to look at the number of sellers in the market. The first point that needs to be remembered is that we are not talking about the number of brands. One seller could have a number of brands in the market. We have to look at the number of sellers in the market. Now, if I start looking at any market structure and I say extremely large number of sellers, what does that mean? An extremely large number of sellers means that one of the most cited examples that I can remember my class 12 teacher telling me, that you look at agriculture. And agriculture is extremely large number of sellers and they're producing homogeneous products. The second condition was not satisfied actually. Extremely large number of sellers, I agree. If you look at the number of farmers that are producing, let's say we're talking about only about wheat. If you look at the number of farmers that are producing wheat and we look at the total output of wheat in the country. So if I divide the total output that is being produced by the total number of farmers, I'll get a number which will be the average productivity of one farmer. Now, if I divide that average productivity of one farmer, the total output that one farmer produces, if you take up any statistical numbers from any, economic survey of India, you look at the number of farmers that are available in who are producing wheat, and you're looking at the total output of wheat production during a particular year, you'll get a number around that one farmer on an average produces 5,000 kilograms of wheat on an average. That's, but this is actually not true. Why this is not true? Because if you go online and you start looking at large producers of wheat, you'll find that not only wheat production is being undertaken by individuals, but wheat production is also being undertaken by corporates. That means corporates do undertake what are called contractual farming. So they would outsource production of wheat, rice, potatoes to farmers and ask them to produce it and supply it to those particular corporates. Coming back, when I use that word extremely large, I'm saying I'll divide the total output of wheat divided by the total number of farmers in the country producing wheat, I'll get the average production of one wheat farmer. It comes down to roughly, as I said earlier, 5,000 kilograms. Now divide 5,000 kilograms by the total production of wheat in this country. Let's take a number, 5,000 kilograms divided by 20 million tons of wheat production. I'm just taking a number. 5,000 kilograms divided by 20 million tons multiplied by 100, and I get the market share of one farmer. The market share of one farmer comes down to 0.00000007. A farmer producing wheat in India does not even have a market share which is 0.00000007. So even if he increases his production from 5,000 kilograms to 10,000 kilograms, doubles it, makes it 10 times, 50,000 kilograms, even then his market share is infinitely small. And that is what is very important for us to understand the word extremely large. Largeness has to be understood in terms of how much of the market does this one seller control. The answer is negligible. That one seller does not control, you know, not even 0.01% of the market. The same is true for extremely large number of buyers. You could do the same exercise with the number of buyers that are there in the country divided by the total production of wheat in the country, get the average consumption of one individual and look at how much is he buying. Does he have any buying power? And you will get again a number which will run into 0.0000 something, that the one single buyer is not buying out of the 20 million tons of food grains that are being produced. He's not even buying, you know, that very, very, you know, a very minor share in the market. So what is the implication? The implication is that no single seller can influence the market price. Now, that's a very important part of perfect competition, because the individual firm has no say in the working of the market forces. They cannot influence demand and supply in terms of pricing. They have no influence over the price. The second point that needs to be understood is homogeneous products. Sometimes I feel very amused when when students tell me that they consider tea and coffee to be substitutes. I'll tell you the reason why. To understand that word substitutes, we need to understand the word homogeneous or vice versa. Now, if I say that firms are producing homogeneous products, then I'm saying that there is firm 1 that produces good X1 and there's firm 2 that produces good X2. If one unit of X1 can equally replace one unit of X2, then I'm looking at homogeneous products, that they are identical. Now, to understand identical products, I need to understand two parts. Number one, are they technologically identical products? And number two, are they economically identical products? When I use the word that the two products are technologically identical, I have to understand, because remember why we talk about competitive strategy. If you know that your product is identical to that of your competitor, then you would need to, and you go to compete in the market, then you need to find out ways and means to differentiate your offer. And that is why understanding homogeneity becomes very important. Homogeneous products or identical products coming from two different firms implies that they are technical, perfect technical substitutes or perfect technological substitutes. Perfect technical substitute means that in terms of their ingredients, in terms of their design, in terms of their functionality, in terms of their benefits, they are identical. A very good example of identical products in the pharmaceutical industry happen to be generic medicines. The salt composition in those medicines is the same. The branding is different. The pricing is different. But the chemical composition remains the same. They are good or perfect technological substitutes. You know, you could look at paracetamol and you could say, okay, firm A makes paracetamol, firm B makes paracetamol, right? They are identical. They are technologically identical given the mg of the tablet that you have. But firms have started even competing on the mg level today. There is paracetamol that is available which is 500 mg and there is paracetamol that is available at 650 mg. That means the efficacy of the medicine changes. But coming back to the concept of homogeneous products, they are identical in terms of their technical composition. The second part in homogeneity requires, are they available to the customer at the same price? Now, why does perfect economic substitutes become important? Homogeneity has to be understood always from the customer's point of view. If the customer is considering or even perceiving that good X1 and good X2 are identical products, then they are to be considered as homogeneous. Now, this is a very subjective and relative concept. That means we need to again study the market and see, is the market treating tea and coffee as substitute products? If they are, then they are substitutes. According to me, even a Pepsi cola drink and a Coke cola drink are distant substitutes. Why are they distant substitutes? They may be available at the same price in given the quantum that is being offered. Let's say a 500 ml bottle or a 650 ml bottle that you're buying, they may be available at the same price. They may be of the same brown quality, you know, brown cola drinks. But do they have the same taste and flavoring? The answer is no. Coca-Cola has an offering called Thumbs Up. Now, Thumbs Up is also a cola drink, but the taste of Thumbs Up is very different from that of Coca-Cola and is very different from that of Pepsi. The taste differs, the flavoring differs. And if the majority of your target audience considers a Thumbs Up to be different from a Pepsi, to be different from a Coke, then they are not identical. They are distant substitutes, right? They're technologically not the same. Why am I so much concerned about product homogeneity? Because we need to understand that if I have homogeneous products, let's say a market structure like oligopoly. Let's take the Delhi market for a minute. If I look at the Delhi market and I look at an administered, in a way, oligopoly, wherein I'm looking at gas cylinders. You know, a lot of families in Delhi use LPG gas, LPG. Those cylinders that come in at, 16.7 kilograms red colored cylinder that is made available to you for home cooking. Now, there are three players in this market in terms of, you know, those who fill the gas and make it available to you. One, there is Indian Oil. They have a brand called Indane. Then there's another player that is Bharat Petroleum. They have their cylinders under the brand name of Bharat Gas. And there's Hindustan Petroleum with a brand called HP Gas. Now, all three players have virtually identical products. They are technologically identical. Even the price is virtually identical for all these three companies in that oligopoly. Technologically, they are identical. Economically, they are identical. That means the consumers are able to avail those services at the same price. But firms are differentiating their offer in terms of, for example, one firm, let's say HP Gas or Bharat Gas or Indane, could say that, look, once the customer places the order, we'll deliver it to you in the next 6 hours. The gas cylinder will reach to you. So they are competing on the basis of delivery. Another company could say that, look, we will compete on the basis of consumer complaints. That is to say, somebody calls up and says that, look, I think that the gas cylinder is leaking, I can smell it, and we need to get it changed, or somebody has to come up. So in case you are able to provide the service delivery in a very short span of time, that means somebody can address that grievance in the shortest possible time, then you are creating a competitive advantage and you are differentiating your offer from that of the competitor. So homogeneity provides us a platform to understand to what extent my product offering is identical to that of the competitor, and if they are identical, then how can I differentiate under conditions of monopolistic competition? I can differentiate under oligopoly, duopoly, and obviously monopoly, you are the sole, you're producing a product for which there are no close substitutes.